New York Times and Scientific America on the origin of life. First, the New York Times. This is a screenshot from, as you can see, February 21, 2011. Those of you who want to find it can find it at the reference listed. It's by Dennis Overby, and we'll run into that name again, so you know. Keep it in the back of your head. As we begin, it starts out Tempe, Arizona. We're not in the Garden of Eden anymore. It always fascinates me when people use biblical references. Obviously, they're thinking in biblical terms. Darwin speculated that life began in a warm pond on the primordial earth. Many of you will remember that. Lately, other scientists have suggested that the magic joining of molecules that could go on replicating might have happened in an undersea hot spring, on another planet, or inside an asteroid. Some astronomers wonder if it could be happening right now under the ice of Europa or in the methane seas of Titan. 24 chemists, geologists, biologists, and planetary scientists and physicists gathered here recently to ponder where and what Eden might have been. Over a long weekend, they plastered the screen in their conference room with intricate chemical diagrams through which electrons bounced in a series of interactions like marbles rattling up and down and over bridges through one of those child's toys, transferring energy, taking care of the business of nascent life. The names of elements and molecules tripped off chemists' tongues as if they were the eccentric relatives who show up at Thanksgiving every year. And the next slide will show something that looks horribly irreverent, and I am not making this up. Doesn't look very dignified, but we'll move on. They charted the fall of meteorites and the rise of oxygen on the early Earth and evidence in old rocks that life was here as long as 3.5 billion years ago. The planet is only a billion years older, but estimates vary on when it became habitable. Might have been much less than that. In front of a 2,400-member audience one night, they debated the definition of life. Anything highly statistically improbable, but in a particular direction, in the words of Richard Dawkins, the evolutionary biologist at Oxford. We'll come back to that definition. Or they wondered if it could be defined at all in the absence of a second example to the Earth's biosphere. A web of interdependence, all based on DNA. Can't define life if you have only one example. Hence, the quest for extraterrestrial examples is more than a sentimental use of NASA's dollars. Let's go look for it, said Chris McKay, a planetary scientist at NASA's Ames Research Laboratory in Mountain View, California, who is involved with the Mars Science Laboratory, which will be launched in November. The rapid appearance of complex life in some accounts, like Athena springing from the head of Zeus, in the words of Dr. McKay, has rekindled interest recently in a theory fancied by Francis Crick, one of the discoverers of the double helix, that life originated elsewhere and floated here through space. These days, the favorite candidate for such an extraterrestrial cradle is Mars, which was once a water world. Perhaps some think its microbes hitched a ride to Earth on asteroids. Unless, of course, the microbes went the other way, and what's to be found on Mars are the dead remains of long-lost cousins of Earth. We've crashed more space probes on Mars than anywhere else. It's that interesting, Dr. McKay said. The conference was sponsored by the Origins Project at Arizona State University, in an effort to get people together who don't normally talk to each other, said Lawrence Krauss, a physicist who helped organize the meeting. Talk is indeed hard across disciplines and geological ages. John Sutherland, a biochemist at Cambridge University in England, said geologists and astronomers were more interested in talking and speculating about the origin of life than chemists were. Interesting. Even though it is basically a problem of nitty-gritty chemistry. The reason, he explained, is that chemists know how hard it is. The modern version of the Garden of Eden goes by the name of RNA world, after the molecule ribonucleic acid, which plays Robin to DNA's Batman today, but is now thought to have preceded it on the biological scene. RNA is more versatile, being able not only to store information like DNA, but also to use that information to catalyze reactions, a job now performed by proteins. That solved a sort of chicken and egg problem about which ability came first in the world. By the way, chicken and egg, remember, is irreducibly complex. The answer is that RNA could be both. If you want to think of it that way, life is a very simple process, said Sidney Altman, who shared a Nobel Prize in 1989 for showing that RNA had these dual abilities. It uses energy, it sustains itself, and it replicates. That's an interesting take. One lesson of the meeting was how finicky are the chemical reactions needed for carrying out these simple-sounding functions. There might be a reason why amino acids and nucleotides are the way they are, Dr. Krauss said. Yeah, I suppose so. What looks complicated to us might not look so complicated to a piece of a carbon molecule, whatever a carbon molecule is, awaiting integration into life's dance. Sorry, this is New York Times, not the actual chemist. I don't think they would phrase it that way. Complexity is in the eye of the beholder. Well, that's kind of an interesting point, said Dr. Sutherland, who after 10 years of trying different recipes succeeded in synthesizing one of the four nucleotides that make up RNA in a jar in his lab. With the right mixture and conditions, complicated-looking molecules can assemble themselves without help. When everything is in the pot, he said, the chemistry to make RNA is easier. Dr. Sutherland's results were hailed as a triumph for the RNA world idea. Excuse me. But there's much to be done, said Steve Benner, who constructs artificial DNA at the Foundation for Applied Molecular Evolution in Florida. Nobody knows whether Dr. Sutherland's recipe would work on the early Earth, he said. Moreover, even if RNA did appear naturally, the odds that it would happen in the right sequence to drive Darwinian evolution seems small. Yeah, that's a bit of an understatement. Other than that, Dr. Benner said, the RNA world is a great idea for the origin of life. Kind of reminds you of, other than that, Mrs. Lincoln, how was the show? Some others, including astronomers and geologists, have another view of biological inevitability. Life is a natural consequence of geology, said Everett Schock, a geophysicist at Arizona State. Well, you can see the chemists and the biologists do have some divergences there. Most of what life is doing is using chemical energy, Dr. Schock said. And that energy is available in places like undersea volcano vents where life, he calculated, acts as a catalyst to dissipate heat from the Earth. Okay. In what he called a sweet deal, right, life releases energy rather than consuming it, making it easy from a thermodynamic standpoint. That's a fascinating perspective. Biosynthesis is profitable. It has to be. They live there. Well, biosynthesis is profitable above ground, too. It's just, how do you make it work? Said Dr. Schock, referring to microbes in undersea vents. Some scientists say we won't really understand life until we can make it ourselves. On the last day of the conference, J. Craig Venter, the genome decoding entrepreneur and president of the J. Craig Venter Institute, described his adventures trying to create an organism with a computer for a parent. "We'll create panspermia if it didn't already exist," he said. Sounds like he thinks it might have already existed. The new genome included what Dr. Venter called a watermark. Along with the names of the researchers were three quotations from the author James Joyce, Robert Oppenheimer, who directed the building of the atomic bomb, and the Caltech physicist Richard Feynman, "What I cannot build, I do not understand." Remember that last quote because it comes up next. I'm going to skip over the next paragraph because it's not helpful here. But the paragraph after that starts, "Then Caltech called up and complained that Dr. Venter's genome was misquoting Feynman. The Institute sent a photograph of an old blackboard on which Feynman had written, 'What I cannot create, I do not understand,' instead of 'build.'" And so his, I presume Dr. Venter's genome, is now in the process of acquiring its first non-Darwinian mutation. Quite an interesting article. Interesting enough that Scientific American picked up on it. This is by John Horgan on February 28, 2011, just a few days later. And it's entitled, "Pssst, Don't Tell the Creationists, But Scientists Don't Have a Clue How Life Began." No, honest. You can look it up yourself. There it is, and here's a screenshot. They know. Article begins with this little thing by an Italian artist, Tintoretto or something like that, who drew God creating the animals. I guess the God creating man from the Sistine Chapel has been just used too much. And then starts out, "Exactly 20 years ago, I wrote an article for Scientific American that in draft form had the headline above, 'Don't tell the creationists,' whatever. My editor nixed it. So we went with something less dramatic. 'In the beginning, scientists are having a hard time agreeing on when, where, and most important, how life first emerged on the earth.' That editor is gone now, so I get to use my old headline, which is even more apt today. Dennis Overby just wrote a status report for the New York Times, which we just read now, on research into life's origin based on a conference on the topic at Arizona State University. Geologists, chemists, astronomers, and biologists are as stumped as ever by the riddle of life. After its formation, 4.5 billion years ago, Earth was bombarded for millions of years by huge meteorites, which would have wiped out any fledgling organisms. Researchers have found evidence for microbial life dating back 3.5 billion years ago, suggesting that life emerged fairly quickly. Like Athena springing from the head of Zeus, as one scientist quoted by Overby put it. But how exactly did chemistry first make the transition to biology? As recently as the middle of the 20th century, many scientists thought that the first organisms were made of self-replicating proteins. After Francis Crick and James Watson showed that DNA is the basis for genetic transmission in the 1950s, many researchers began to favor nucleic acids over proteins as the molecules. But there was a major hitch in this scenario. DNA can make neither proteins nor copies of itself without the help from catalytic proteins called enzymes. This fact turned the origin of life into a classic chicken or egg puzzle. Which came first, proteins or DNA? RNA, DNA's helpmate, remains the most popular answer to this conundrum, just as it was when I wrote In the Beginning. Certain forms of RNA can act as their own enzymes, snipping themselves in two and splicing themselves back together again. If RNA could act as an enzyme, then it might be able to replicate itself without help from proteins. RNA could serve as gene and catalyst, egg, and chicken. But the RNA world hypothesis remains problematic. RNA and its components are difficult to synthesize under the best of circumstances in a laboratory, let alone under plausible prebiotic conditions. Once RNA is synthesized, it can make new copies of itself only with a great deal of chemical coaxing from the scientists. Overby notes that, quote, even if RNA did appear naturally, the odds that it would happen in the right sequence to drive Darwinian evolution seem small. The RNA world is so dissatisfying that some frustrated scientists are resorting to much more far out, literally, speculation. The most startling revelation in Overby's article is that scientists have resuscitated a proposal once floated by Crick. Dissatisfied with conventional theories of life's beginning, Crick conjectured that aliens came to Earth in a spaceship and planted the seeds of life here billions of years ago. This notion is called directed panspermia. In less dramatic versions of panspermia, microbes arrived on our planet via asteroids, comets, or meteorites, or drifted down like confetti. One enormous change in the past two decades in the quest to understand our origins, which Overby also reported on recently, is that astronomers have identified more than 1,000 possible planets orbiting other stars. Some seem to be in the Goldilocks zone, neither too far nor too close to their respective stars for life as we know it to prosper. Perhaps we are descended from life that emerged on one of those planets. Those of you who've been here long enough may remember we've talked some about that. Of course, panspermia theories merely push the problem of life's origin into outer space. If life didn't begin here, how did it begin out there? Creationists are no doubt thrilled that origin of life research has reached such an impasse. See, for example, the screed Darwinism Refuted, which cites my 1991 article. But they shouldn't be. Their explanation suffered from the same flaw. What created the divine creator? And at least scientists are making an honest effort to solve life's mysteries instead of blaming it all on God. Okay, that, of course, had creation safaris comment on the Scientific American article, which was commenting on the New York Times article on the origin of life. And you can find that on the internet, too. Creationists don't blame God. They thank him and worship him for the marvel of life. Do you see the anti-creator hysteria that leads evolutionists to frantic rants of desperation to keep from admitting the obvious, that life was created? Thanks to John for being honest enough to admit the problem, something the news media almost never do, but then he played dog in the manger. We might be clueless, frustrated, desperate, empty-handed, and broke, but nobody else gets to play the origins game. And there's more to that. I'm not going to comment further on that. Now, my own take on that is the article doesn't really sound very positive about a mechanistic explanation for the origin of life, does it? Perhaps this is because the definition of life is somewhat suspect. They don't know what they're looking for. Dawkins gives that definition early on, anything highly statistically improbable, but in a particular direction. So if you have a tray of 500 pennies and 65% of them are heads, then that's life. Somehow that seems to me to be kind of a weak definition of life. Or Sidney Altman, if you want to think of it that way, life is a very simple process. It uses energy, it sustains itself, and it replicates. Can anybody think of something that is not life that does that? What? Computer? How about fire? It replicates, it uses energy, it sustains itself. So somehow I think we can do better than that. Or Maybe it can't be defined at all in the absence of a second example to the Earth's biosphere, a web of interdependence all based on DNA. On the other hand, maybe DNA should be part, or at least something like DNA should be part of the definition. So let's see if we can do better. Well, let's start with looking at other examples of the definition of life. Well, there are textbooks, and I just went out and looked at the three biology textbooks I could find really quickly, and I apologize they're not last year's, but you know, they're 2006, 2008. They're pretty recent, within the last 10 years, and they probably haven't changed that much. So Miller and Levine. Miller, of course, is the Miller that's active against the intelligent design movement. And he has a paragraph that I'll read the whole thing because it A is short and B, I think it's a good summary. Characteristics of living things. Are the firefly and the fire in figure 114 alive? That's a good question. What distinguishes life from fire? You know, most of us look at life and we're kind of like, I think it was Justice Stevens, the comment on pornography, I can't define it, but I know it when I see it. And I think that, you know, we kind of have an idea that fire's not alive, that all the people in this room are alive, that there's a transition from life to death, and the definition of life should give us some clue as to when that happens. And so we're going to keep those kinds of questions in mind while we're looking at this. They are both giving off energy, so energy obviously isn't the only thing. Describing what makes something alive is not easy. No single characteristic is enough to describe a living thing. Also, some non-living things share one or more traits with living things. Mechanical toys, automobiles, and clouds move around, for example, whereas mushrooms and trees live their lives in one spot. So motion is not an adequate thing. Other things, such as viruses, exist at the border between organisms and non-living things. You'll read more about viruses in chapter 19. For now, I'm going to kind of ignore them and maybe bring them in at the very end if we want to. Despite these difficulties, it is possible to describe what most of these things have in common. And then there's a little key symbol, which I assume for a textbook means this is key. Unfortunately, I couldn't find something to put it up there, but it looks like a slage key or something like that for a house. Living things share the following characteristics, and that's in bold in the original. And then I'm going to skip so you can see all the characteristics at one slide. Living things are made up of units called cells. Living things reproduce. Living things are based on a universal genetic code. Living things grow and develop. Living things obtain and use materials and energy. Living things respond to their environment. Living things maintain a stable internal environment. And finally, taken as a group, living things can change over time. Now, well, let's not just take one textbook. Let's pick Campbell. And he has a long section of the life has DNA with code. And then he goes on to say, let's list some of the other properties that are common to all organisms. One, order. All living things exhibit complex organization, as seen in the highly ordered structures of the sunflower, shown in figure 1.4b. Regulation. The environment outside an organism may change markedly, but mechanisms regulate an organism's internal environment, maintaining it within limits that sustain life. For example, regulation of the amount of blood flowing through the blood vessels in the large ears of the jackrabbit in figure 1.4c, and that's just a regular jackrabbit. helps maintain a constant body temperature by adjusting heat exchange with the air. 3, growth and development. Inherited information carried by genes controls an organism's pattern of growth and development. 4, energy utilizations. Organisms take in energy and transform it to perform all of life's activities. 5, response to the environment. All organisms respond to environmental stimuli. The Venus flytrap in figure 1.4D closes its trap rapidly in response to the environmental stimulus of a cricket landing on it. Picture looked more like, to me, a katydid landing on it, but whatever. 6, reproduction. Organisms reproduce their own kind. Figure 1.4E shows a panda with its baby. 7, evolution. Reproduction underlines the capacity of species to change or evolve over time. Evolutionary change has been a central unifying feature of life since it arose 4 billion years ago. And then Brooker et al., and I'm not going to read any of his stuff, of the text, because it's long and it has much of the same content. The properties of life, a set of characteristics, is common to all forms of modern life, and these are just the titles. Cells and organization, energy use and metabolism, response to environmental change, regulation and homeostasis, growth and development, reproduction, and biological evolution. So, sounds kind of similar all the way around. Well, let's see how similar it is. Well, here's Miller and Levine. And it starts up with made up of units called cells. Order, cells, and organization, yeah, pretty much the same thing. Then let's start with reproduction. Reproduction, yeah, that's the same. Okay, I'm going to skip over based on the universal genetic code for now. We'll come back to that. Growth and development, grow and develop. Let's see, growth and development, yeah. Okay, obtain and use materials and energy utilization, energy use and metabolism, yeah, pretty much the same. Okay, response to environmental changes, yeah, I'd call that a match. Maintain an external, in a stable internal environment, regulation and homeostasis regulation, probably pretty much the same idea. And finally, taken as a group, change over time, evolution, biological evolution, I think that's what they're referring to. Now let's go back to that based on a universal genetic code. It's kind of extra, but remember Campbell started out with one that really should have been first. I'm going to leave it last, but it was first DNA, genetic code. And you'll find that Brooker, in fact, has DNA in this cells and organization thing. So, yeah, that's really, you know, part of the same complex. So, basically, it's the same list. Now, what about that? Well, living things are made of, I'm just going to use Miller and Levine's list because it's probably the most complete. Living things are made up of units called cells. Mostly true. Not 100%. Slime molds turn out to be a whole bunch of nuclei inside one big bag. In fact, that's even not true for humans. The placenta contains something called the syncytiotrophoblast, which is one big cell with a whole bunch of nuclei. Platelets are giant cells that have several nuclei that pinch off little pieces that have no nuclei. And red blood cells are, well, they're cells, but they don't have nuclei. So, not quite 100% true. But I will have to say I think it contains a grain of truth. And that is that living cells have to have an inside and an outside and a boundary between those two. So we'll keep the kind of the central point of that even while acknowledging exceptions.
But okay. Bacteria.
Well, I'm going to leave viruses out of the account for right now.
Yeah.
Because there's a big debate over whether they're living or not. But
bacteria do not have nuclei.
Bacteria do not have... bacteria have cell walls and cell membranes.
Yeah, but they don't have a membrane around their nucleus.
Well, you don't have to have a membrane around the nucleus. The key here is that they have an inside and outside.
Okay.
See? And so, you know, even though cells is kind of a loose definition, it almost fits, and I think there's a principle behind it that does fit 100%. Okay, now living things reproduce. That's not the core of the definition. You say, but they all do, don't they? Well, that depends. Remember I said it also must mark the difference between life and death. And you see, my mother is unable to reproduce. She is very much alive. As a matter of fact, there may be people around who have not been able to reproduce since they were children. They're still alive. So even though reproduction may be kind of required for living things to keep going in a world where there is death, it's not really the fundamental part of the definition. So, now, it's a requirement with death a reality, but it's not getting to the core of what it means to be alive. Okay? Living things are based on a universal genetic code. Well, that's not actually true either. The paramecium has a different code from most other life forms. Definitely from you and me, and in fact, we in ourselves have a second code in the mitochondria that's significantly different from the one that we have in the nucleus in our cells. So it's not a universal genetic code, but I think that, again, we're getting close to a truth that's important. Living things may need some kind of code. Okay, living things grow and develop. Well, what about spores? Are they alive or not? I think most people would say they're alive. Although I guess you could say they're kind of in the gray zone there. Dormant, perhaps. But they're certainly more alive than, let's say, dead rats. Again, my mother, she is not growing. What she is doing, except in her mind, is probably better characterized as degenerating. But she's still alive. Now, it may be necessary to grow and develop, in a world where there is death that will eventually take every living thing. Maybe you need some... just like you need reproduction. But we're not talking about something that's central to the definition of life. Living things obtain and use materials and energy. Well, again, spores don't seem to be obtaining and using materials and energy, but perhaps, again, we're pointing to something that's important. I think we're getting closer to the definition of life. They use materials and energy. They respond to their environment. Again, you have spores that don't seem to be responding much to their environment, although I guess if you put them in just the right environment, they will respond to it. But again, we're getting close to the definition of life. And in living things that maintain a stable internal environment, I think we're almost there. That's a very close part to what we're looking for. And taken as a group, living things change over time. Well, the truth of the matter is, that's not true. And that's not true in a few exceptions, but that's not true as a rule. Sharks are virtually the same as they were supposedly 500 million years ago. Algae are the same as they were supposedly 3 billion years ago. No change whatsoever, at least as far as we can tell. So you can't have a definition that say sharks and algae are not living. I think that this particular one, it's interesting and always given last, is an ideological sop to Darwin. I think that the core of life has to do with something else than this, and actually all of these criteria, if we can kind of, we're going to have to refine them just a little bit in order to define life properly. Now, I'm going to make a stab at it, and you guys can criticize it after we get done here. Life has a complex arrangement of material that is organized in such a way that it can routinely take in disorganized or perhaps differently organized, because those of us who eat other forms of life, obviously, whether plants or animals, take them apart and re-put them together, but re-put them together in our own form and rearrange them to perpetuate its own organization, all by means of coded information. Now, I'm going to be careful and not say life is. It's possible that life is more than that. Possible that certain forms of life are more than that. But at least, if it doesn't have that, it's probably not life. If it does have that, it's probably fair to call it life. Now, you'll notice that I didn't say anything about DNA, because perhaps there is DNA that has arsenic in it. Now, there's a famous case of that kind that really didn't pan out. But if it had panned out, I think it's fair to say that would have been life. Perhaps you can make life using silicon instead of carbon. But regardless, you're going to have a complex thing that has coded information, because it's complex enough to need it. And you'll notice that that definition requires complexity. It requires, in fact, specified complexity in a sense, because it's specified by the coded information. Reproduction is not an essential requirement, although, of course, in a world where death is common, it would be. The potential for metabolism, but not growth, is an essential requirement. Regulation is built in. Energy and materials are virtually required. Response to the environment is virtually required, because it has to keep itself the way it is in spite of the environment. And evolution is not required, and of course it doesn't appear to be necessary anyway. And we'll go back to it. Not too far. By this definition, my mother is alive. And that's important. The definition seems to require a sort of specified complexity, complex and specified by the code. This explains why John Sutherland reportedly said that geologists and astronomers were more interested in talking and speculating about the origin of life than chemists were, even though it is basically a problem of nitty-gritty chemistry. The reason he explained is that all chemists know how hard it is. This requires something really tough to do. One lesson of the meeting, I think, was how finicky are the chemical reactions needed for carrying out these simple-sounding functions. There might be a reason why amino acids and nucleotides are the way they are, Dr. Krauss said. In my opinion, that's life. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. Actually, I'm going to take one more second. For those of you who are interested, the background is a stromatolite pad. Stock photo from Wikipedia, I believe. And I'll just leave the definition up there in case you want to criticize it. We comment back here and one over here.
It seems to me as though DNA is not all that different than RNA. I mean, it's one base pair different. So does anybody have an idea here why RNA is able to, for example, be enzymes, but DNA is not? Or might it be possible to create a DNA that, in fact, does have enzymatic activity?
Probably the answer to that resides in the other difference between DNA and RNA, and that is the extra oxygen on ribose, or if you prefer, the lack of an oxygen on carbon 2 of deoxyribose. And that means that there's an extra hydroxyl group that is available to catalyze reactions if necessary. In fact, it has to be that way in a certain sense because deoxyribose with just a hydrogen on that one position does not have a hydroxyl group sticking out anywhere. Anything on the basis is carbon doubly bonded to oxygen or carbon singly bonded to nitrogen. And so the hydroxyl group probably helps with the enzymatic activity that's necessary, whereas DNA does not have that. But it is an interesting question. Could somebody see if DNA had some catalytic activity? And we might be surprised it may. The thing to keep in mind is that RNA doesn't, now that we've established it has some catalytic activity, it does not mean that it has anywhere near the catalytic activity of proteins.
Well, there's so many different types of amino acids, it seems like you have a lot more tools in the bag for proteins than for RNA.
No, that's exactly right. RNA is a very poor substitute. People got excited because they needed a molecule that would do both. This does both, but the enzymatic function is not very good.
Coming to your definition here, I think you are probably correct because you have that word routinely in there. But
that was crafted carefully.
Can't a computer do all of these things, maybe not routinely?
Well, that's an interesting point. Supposing that you were to make a computer that had sensing instruments that could tell whether there was iron ore in it or iron ore in the environment, and that had something that was able to, well, first of all, reproduce its own software and put it where it belonged, and then reproduce its own hardware. We're not anywhere near there yet, but would it be fair to call that living? Probably so. It's an interesting philosophical question. If it were alive, it would be an entirely different kingdom.
You might call it living, but I might not.
Yeah. It wouldn't necessarily be, you know, living in the sense that as humans are. That's a whole different question.
But my whole reaction to this, these articles and so on is, why are they spending so much of their time down here in the very simple RNA world and totally ignoring all the tremendous organization you have to have of that RNA before you get anywhere near a living organism to the extent of 10 to the 1 millionth power. You remember? They're down there playing with very simple little toys and seem to ignore the reality beyond that.
Well, that's very simple. It's because they need to bridge this gap. If they do not bridge this gap, a naturalistic explanation for the universe fails. And they know it. And that's what this boils down to. This is the biggest gap in the naturalistic explanation for the universe. Is we have life, and we have no clue how it started without some kind of a designer. And some kind of a designer, if you start asking the question, rapidly goes back to some kind of a designer whose intelligence is not based on the organization of matter.
Yeah, well, my point is they're missing the main part of the gap by concentrating just on RNA, DNA, and ignoring, hey, you can have all the RNA you want. If you don't have the information for making proteins and all this stuff, it's not going to work.
See, that's why my definition includes a code. That brings up the question of where'd the code come from? And you can't answer that. Your theory is no good. Comment here and one back there. I guess a couple of them back there.
I got a question. Do you think angels are alive?
I thought of that. Unfortunately, I have no specimens to examine.
Well, this is kind of making my point here. It seems like your definition always has to take in some category specification. And if you have a limited specification, your definition is going to be limited. If you add a specification, well, then you're going to have to change your definition again.
That's true.
So
we may not.
What's the point?
Well, the point is that all of life that we know of on Earth that is not supposed to be supernatural. Now, I say supposed to be because there's some argument that we ourselves are in some sense supernatural. But all of life that's not supposed to be supernatural, in fact, requires an incredible code.
Of course, we do worship a living God, and we worship him in spirit.
Yes.
Outside the realm of material.
And there are philosophical reasons for arguing that God, rather than being supremely complex, is in fact supremely simple. And if that's the case, then code and DNA probably don't fit with him. And it's difficult to make a definition of life that would not include God if he exists, which I think he does. So that is a problem. That's a similar problem to that of angels. Unfortunately, no one, according to the best resources I can find, no one has seen God.
Nobody's put an angel on the table either to look at him.
The time that we did see him, he apparently had DNA. Yes.
I think it was on a NOVA program this week that dealt with the origin of life in rocks. And you can correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems that if you take rocks down to their minimalist example, the very simplest parts, that those parts can combine easily or more easily. And it was well illustrated, as NOVA programs are, with bouncing things and colorful things, and it appeals to a person of my non-scientific abilities. Is there a possibility that even these things you have on the screen evolved in that manner, of the simplest molecules being able to combine?
If you ask, is there a possibility, I would have to say, well, I guess. It's not one that I would put much money on in terms of betting, but yeah, it's there. It's probably, you're probably better odds putting your money on Powerball. Yes.
I'm a little confused about your mother. You said earlier that the fact that she couldn't reproduce negated the definition of life by one of these books. But yet in this slide, you say that perpetuating its own organization is the definition of life. So what's the difference between perpetuating its own organization versus your mother not being able to reproduce?
Well, my mother can perpetuate her own organization until a certain point at which she is unable to do so. That point has not been reached yet, and so she is still alive.
You could say that the human race is capable of reproduction, whether your mother does or not. There are exceptions.
Yeah, human race. But the point of it is, you don't die if you have a hysterectomy.
Commenting on the spirit versus human, that we worship God in spirit. I think the angels are spirits. God is spirit. He is the author of both energy and matter. Maybe the angels are a sort of an energy form of his creation, and we are more a material form of creation. Created in our brain cells, the matter of our brain cells, with the capacity to offer him spiritual worship, but we do not have a spirit separate from our body. And Jesus came to give us life, life more abundant than we have if we do not worship him. And it seems like we have an opening to a much richer definition of what the spiritual life is like, not as a separate spirit, but in the use of our brain cells and our biochemistry, the matter of our being can all be spiritually worshiping God.
Well, that's true. I am not offering this as a definition that should be put back into the Bible. That would be anachronistic at best. What I'm offering is something that helps us understand why lichens are different from, I'm trying to think what they call it, desert glaze.
Desert varnish?
Desert varnish, yeah. That there's something fundamentally different between the two. Lichens are alive, desert varnish is not. And it can even go into saying that when lichens can no longer maintain their internal organization, they are then dead, and they are then non-living, in spite of the fact that they look just like the regular lichens. Desert varnish. If you see rocks in the desert, you will sometimes see this kind of layer on top of them. And it usually looks kind of dark. And it's assumed to be minerals that have been leached out of the rock kind of onto the surface. And because they're usually, have a little more iron oxide than the surface does. it looks kind of pretty until somebody breaks it away, and then you can see the lighter rock underneath. See, lichens cover rocks just like desert varnish covers rocks, but they're not the same thing.
It's complicated by the fact that some desert varnish seems to have organisms contributing.
That's
to
true.
It in the,
and those organisms would be alive, whereas the desert varnish would not. The actual coating. And that's the important thing is that, you know, if you're going to study biology, you want to ask, well, what are we studying? And the answer, I think, this is as close to an answer as I can get, but the important thing is that it requires a code. And that code means information. And that means that central to life is information. And if you can't explain information, you can't explain life. It just happened. The other thing is, it just happened is not an adequate reason.
Yes. Now that you remove the inclusion of being able to reproduce, I think those that promote the Gaia hypothesis would be pleased with your definition of life here, because it fits well the idea that the Earth is a complex living organism, the planet itself.
Well, they may not be that far off from the truth. God originally intended the whole thing to fit together, each part supplying the needs of the other. Plants were made not just for themselves, but for animals to eat. Animals were originally made not to eat each other, but to eat the plants. And that's the way it is. And, you know, Gaia puts a kind of a theology behind it, and the theology may or may not be correct, but the observation probably is a good one.
Does your discussion here is, you know, your underlying philosophy is different from those that were part of that conference. I mean, they're coming from a perspective of pure scientism, and what you are trying to do is respond not from scientism, but with a more metaphysical capacity.
Actually, that's not true. And the reason I can tell you it's not true is that nothing that I have put up here says that there has to be any kind of metaphysics behind it. This is all chemistry. It's just saying it doesn't work really
well. Yeah, but I'm just saying that your discussion explores the capacity of your definition to include angels and whatever, you know,
you added that, to be fair.
Okay.
I'm talking about the physical life that we can see.
Okay.
And that's one of the reasons why, if you add it, we may find out that angels are made by an extra special chemistry of entirely different rules, with entirely different particles, for all we know.
We
may find out that God himself is different. But, you know, this is a definition for life as we know it here on Earth, and that would be flexible enough to include other kinds of life.
How do chemists who believe in evolution explain consciousness, thought, and self-determination?
Consciousness is known as the hard problem of consciousness. And it's hard because it has not been solved.
It's an emerging property.
Emergent is poof. I mean, it means you get complicated enough and suddenly stuff happens. Exactly how that happens they're usually sure that it has nothing to do with anything beyond atoms and molecules. You know, that it's just, there is no spiritual end to it whatsoever. And they may be right about life, but for consciousness, there's actually some proof that they are wrong that's pretty reasonable. We talked about that a couple months ago, I think. Maybe about three or four. I'd have to look back exactly how far it is. But, yeah, that's a hard problem. And they don't have a solution. And I think the reason they don't is because you can show that a computer model is simply inadequate to explain consciousness. But this only deals with life. And the fact of the matter is that life is the biggest problem they have, but it is not by any means the only problem.
When you insert into the definition that life needs to be evolving, you're putting a trajectory on the individual species or the persons or whomever's living. And that, therefore, you're bringing in ideas of consciousness, you're bringing ideas of thought, you're bringing ideas of self-determination, and who or what is guiding that process?
Well, they don't think so.
And why are they defining it the way that they do?
Because, first of all, evolution happens, and evolution must be, it simply must be, the thing without which biology does not make sense. So if they didn't put evolution in there, it would be an admission that the definition of life doesn't require evolution. It's an ideological gloss at the end, literally at the end of all three. And the interesting thing that I find is that nobody is arguing that because sharks haven't evolved, they're not alive. Or because horseshoe crabs haven't evolved, that they're not alive. Or because algae haven't evolved, that they're not alive. I mean, you can just go through the list, and nobody says that. Life does not have to evolve in order to be alive. And everybody really knows that. Even when Miller and Levine put in their definition, you notice that they says taken as a group. They won't say the individual has to evolve because it's obviously nonsense. My mother is not evolving. If anything, she's devolving. Well, that's life here on Earth. But she's very much alive. And it's interesting because the ideology pushes them in the direction of evolution, which is not necessary, and blinds them to the fact that the key, the single key about it is so complex that it requires a code to keep it working. You have to store that information somewhere. And you see, that's the hard problem of life, in parallel to the hard problem of consciousness. Anyway, come back next week and we'll talk about the digging of the Grand Canyon, and we'll try to keep you abreast of other things that I run into here and there. And those of you who have thoughts that you can share here would be greatly appreciated.